Yes, yes, y'all. From the, what is this? This is a I don't know the name of the convention center. From whatever convention center.
I have no idea. J.B. Gonzalez?
Yeah, that sounds right. In San Antonio, Texas, at the site of the THSCA Coaching School and Convention. It is DCTF Live, an internet show that is not live presently. You are watching or listening to a recording happening on Monday morning. It is the first, today is July 18th, 2016, episode 170. I don't know. I don't have my internet, so I can't tell
That's
you.
That's true.
I can't tell you.
I'm you just going to
say.
Give us a stat?
I'm just going to say 170. Number of games okay. The Rangers are going to win this year.
All right.
My name is Greg Tepper. I'm the managing editor of Dave Campbell's Texas Football and TexasFootball.com. That's the voice of God over there. sitting over there is Max Thompson. Hi, Max.
It's weird. How much do you think it costs to get God to be the PA guy here? It's got to be a steep price, right?
Yeah, I mean, listen, I bet they've
a couple fish and some bread.
I bet they've signed him to a longer term deal, though. Like this is I think the Henry B. Gonzalez Convention Center strikes me as the kind of people, savvy business people, who understand the value of a long term deal.
Sure.
And say, all right, let's maybe go 5 years.
That's an eternal contract, really.
In many ways, it is. That other voice you hear and that other face you see is Mike Craven, DCTF senior writer. Hi, Mike. This is your hood.
This is. We are sort of. I have a few hoods.
Yeah, you do. You kind of rep. Let's see. Where does he rep? He reps Austin. He reps San Antonio. He'll rep East Texas on you.
Houston.
He definitely will not rep DFW. Though.
No.
Under
no
circumstances.
Then the problem is that if he's not repping DFW, that means that you can't rep anything from Texarkana to El Paso.
It really eliminates over half the state. it limits my writing ability and the content. But, I mean, there's sacrifices that have to be made out of principle.
Listen, I understand that, and I appreciate that you're a man of principle. You are going to be here going to a couple of sessions here. For those who don't know, the THSCA Coaching Convention, a lot of speakers, folks coming in, and I think Chad Morris is talking right now. I don't know what you're even doing here if you're not listening to Chad Morris.
Right, we're figuring out a badge situation.
Oh, badge situation.
We're not exactly sure what our badges get us, Greg.
No.
I think they get us everything.
Do we?
But I'll tell you.
Question. Yeah. Can we go meet God?
That's an interesting
point. Where is the PA room?
That's an interesting sports question. They misspelled for the fifth time in 6 years. They misspelled my badge. It said that my name was Greg Topper.
I like that you scribbled it out, though, because now that doesn't look crooked at all. Like, oh, no, they got my name wrong, so I wrote the right last name
right
here. Like, you didn't kill some guy to get that badge and then sneak in.
You know, I didn't think about that. And now
your instant regret.
And now I'm wondering if
I immediately regret this.
And now I'm wondering if there's a warrant out for my arrest. That would be very bad. We're going to be here today and tomorrow, in theory Wednesday, although this thing kind of shuts down early on Wednesday.
Yeah.
Talking to coaches, doing coach interviews. How was your how was your evening? You arrived last night. What did you end up doing last night?
We got here about 4. Went to Carl Padilla's deal at the Hard Rock Cafe. Talk to the Godfather. Talk to some coaches. For me, it's always interesting to talk to these guys outside of our normal setting of talking to them. Get them off the record. Just kind of get them talking sure. like they're normal people, your normal people, and just be able to talk. So that's what I'm excited about over these next couple of days.
Yeah, so. We talked about this last night over a beer. There's a certain idea you're right. Everybody's more in a relaxed setting. Dave Campbell's over here signing magazines. You're here in a more relaxed setting. And you do. This is the time every coach is in a good mood because they're undefeated. But I will tell you that for me, from a personal perspective, when a coach has a beer in his hand, he's off the record. Like, you can't use anything he says or anything. Like, at that point, like, maybe that's just me, and maybe I just have more ethical druthers. I don't know. Maybe.
That seems.
Is that excessive?
I'm not sure you've ever had any ethical druthers.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I think you probably drink as well, so you kind of understand the
also,
plight
oh,
there.
Yes.
And so I think it probably depends on the coach. If a coach tells you, yeah, it's cool, we can do this little, you know, whatever, no big deal. But, yeah, I would have a hard time approaching a coach with a beer in their hand and going, hey, can I have 5 minutes and talk about your offensive line for 2016?
I say things I regret sober, like, all the time.
Sure.
I have a 30-minute show every weekday right. where I say things I regret almost instantaneously. So, yeah.
How great would it be to have, like, a life rule where everything was off record when you had a beer in your hand? Like,
that's
you could go to your girlfriend or your wife and be like, it was off the record.
You know what? I think there's something involved. I think there's something there. I'm a big believer in the social contract mm-hmm. that when you're born, we all have things that we are required to do and not do. And I think that should be part of the social contract. Is that if you are in a state where you are not, you cannot be reasonably assumed to be sober, I think that at that point, nothing you say counts.
Yep.
Oh, Carl Padilla just walked
up.
Just walking into our recording.
We're on TV. We are quite literally
recording. We're literally recording, Carl. No, I'll be there in a minute, Carl. I will be there in a minute, Carl. Yes.
We're both on TV.
Carl Padilla. Or the PadillaPoll.com.
Yes.
Do you see the lights and the cameras? What are we even doing here? We will be... Okay.
I mean, if you thought we were all professional.
Yeah. We were having like a nice false. Conversation, and then all of a sudden just like people running in. And
yes.
Just terrible. Okay. We're going to be – so I would tell you what's coming up on the show, but we don't know. Going to be coaches running around. We're going to grab them, sit them down, grill them. We're going to put them on the – I made a reference to the Budweiser hot seat yesterday, which is something that hasn't been a thing in like 15 years.
Yes.
Gonna put them in the Dairy Queen
Some
hot
cold
seat.
Hard facts.
The Dairy Max
the Dairy
hot seat.
Max hot
the Dairy Max hot seat.
The chocolate milk seat.
What if we, dude? Let's our friends from Dairy Max are over there. We need some chocolate milk on the desk.
That's true.
That'd be great. We will be back with interviews with a coach to be named later. Next on DCTF Live. We are here at the THSCA Coaching Convention and School in San Antonio, joined by the head coach of the 6A Division II state champion Katy Tigers, Coach Gary Joseph. I imagine you don't get tired of being introduced that way.
Not at all. You know, it's a great deal. It's a great deal for our community, and it's a great deal for our kids and their work ethic, and it speaks very highly of that. And also, it's a great deal for Katy and Katy ISD. You know, you're a multi-school district. You have to have a lot of cooperation to go into this. We've got, you know, a great athletic director, and really and truly, I've got an outstanding coaching staff. And you know, this is not Gary Joseph's show. This is a Katy High School show.
And I'll tell you, the Katy High School show last year was featuring maybe one of the best defenses we have ever seen. I mean, when you look back on that defense, you've been around this game. Your family's been around this game. I imagine you're going to hold the 2015 Katy defense in pretty high esteem.
No question about that. You know, and the great thing, it was a great kids to coach. We enjoyed it. Those kids were very driven. You know, of course, you expect them to be when a lot of them played, you know, young as sophomores. And, you know, they played with the chip on their shoulder, having lost twice to Cedar Hill. And both times in the games, we were ahead in the fourth quarter. So, you know, it really, you know, set them with an edge last year. And we had a little bit of depth, and that really helped us and helps us down the line and stuff because – you know, doubt when we took the other ones out, you know, the drop-off wasn't very good and stuff. So we were able to sit there and maintain a lot of games like that.
And so now moving on to 2016, there is going to be, you know, you lose 8 starters, I believe, from your defense. Bring back 5 on offense, which should be pretty solid, especially a running back we may talk about in a moment. But when you look at rebuilding the defense, putting it all back together, where do you start? How do you move on from that?
Well, you know, we start with our defensive line. You know, we have 2 starters back there, and both our defensive ends are really good football players. You know, Corey Bethley and Michael Maltouche, and both of them are really good football players. And I think it's a great, you know, foundation to start. But, you know, the other linebacker, Raymond Randall, you know, inside linebacker, here in Braden Boyd. Raymond, you know, started 8 games when Patty Fisher was hurt. So it's not like we had no experience coming back there. And, you know, the rebuilding is going to be in the secondary, and I understand you can't be average in the secondary in this day and age and sit there and be real good. But, you know, we've always played great defense. It was just with these kids, it was an exceptional defense and things. And I think, that, you know, we do have some you know, blocks to sit there and build on with Corey and those people. And truthfully, all our, you know, 3 of our 4 secondary kids, you know, were returning lettermen, so they played and they got the experience. They just weren't the guy, and now you always wonder how they're going to react when they're the guy. And so I feel like that we'll be, you know, a good defensive football team for the end of the year.
Speaking of the guy, you guys went back out to the running back tree and plucked out another one. DeAndre Glass looks like he's going to be the next big thing. You've coached, my goodness, you have coached a number of pretty good running backs. What sets DeAndre apart?
Well, really and truthfully, he's just one of those kids that's got great vision, but he's got a burst, you know, about him that he can get. Once he gets to the second level, he can take it all the way and stuff. And, you know, he's been injured, you know, and got hurt in spring ball, and, you know, we're hoping he gets well and stuff. But, you know, he's gained about 20 pounds since last year, so now, it's going to be a little bit different for him, you know, see how he carries the weight that he's gained and stuff. But, you know, you go from 160 to 180 pounds and stuff, you know, and then in our offense, you're going to take some shots and stuff, and it just makes it a lot easier for him to sit there and bounce back. But, you know, his backup is Craven Coplin, and Craven was our backup, one of our backups last year. He missed about 9 games and stuff, so, you know, he's back. So we feel like that the running back position is, you know, in pretty good hands.
I promised you I'd get you out of here in 5 minutes, but okay. I do have to ask you. You may not even be the most famous coach in your own family. You got your sidekick here today is your father, Eddie Joseph, the legend, Eddie Joseph. And I notice every year you guys come up, and he and Eddie Joseph and Dave Campbell are just – they're thick as thieves, those two. I'm telling you, they're planning something.
Well, they're from the same era. You know, and both of them have been a lot to Texas high school football, as have y'all and stuff. I think you want to compliment y'all on what y'all do and promoting high school football in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And you know, that's what we need, what our state needs, is people to sit there and be a part of this and keep promoting it, because it's what's best for kids, and you know, it's what's best for all our programs.
He is Gary Joseph. He's the head coach of the Katy Tigers. Coach, appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.
Back here at THSCA Coaching Convention and Coaching School in San Antonio, joined now by the head coach of one of the schools in the state with the best mascot, the Fort Worth Polytechnic Parrots. It is Coach Chris Roberts. Coach, you're taking a break from harassing me on Twitter and to come down to coaching school.
Yes.
I appreciate your time.
Well, I felt like I had to stop by because you basically guided me on my path yesterday down to San Antonio doing the show on the ticket.
Oh, doing the radio show.
Yes.
Good. Oh, all right. Okay. See, one person listened, Max.
Yeah, one person listened.
You said nobody was listening.
Nobody
one person
was listening.
Listened. So what are you – you're always down – you're always at the coaching conventions. You're a figure that's come by the booth every year. What are you looking for? What do you want to get out of this week? What did you come to San Antonio for besides just to harass me in person instead of on Twitter?
The main thing is if I can get one or two things that I can take back mm-hmm. with me and implement this year in our program, then it's success for me. Mm-hmm. The second reason is usually we're always trying to find somebody to hire. Mm-hmm. And so paying attention to what's going on down in the job room, that's probably the second thing we're doing.
You guys have had a relatively remarkable turnover as far as assistants are concerned and just kind of as far as staff is concerned. You're looking for people to hire and stuff like mm-hmm. that. For you as the head coach and the guy who has to pull it all together, how difficult is it when you maybe don't have that kind of continuity from year to year, you know, decade to decade, if you will?
It's definitely tough. The thing that had been fortunate up until this year was that at least my coordinators had stayed the same. Mm-hmm. This year we'll have two new coordinators, and so that's going to be the biggest transition. So what I look for is people that I have a coaching relationship with that know me, I know them, know that their style will be a good fit with our kids. And then hopefully that trickles down to the younger assistants that they're going to want to stick around and see things all the way through.
You guys had a tough year last year, 0-10. What do you tell your kids? I think that I've always thought, for example, we had Coach Gary Joseph on the mm-hmm. on the show from Katy. I think his conversation with his kids, real easy to have. You see what we did last year? Go do that.
Right.
You know? What's your conversation like with your kids where you've got to, you know, where you're telling them, let's go out there and fight and claw and go get a couple of wins?
the conversation is really, it's really not about football, and it's not about wins and losses. Mm-hmm. Everybody uses the word the process. You hear it 80 million times.
From Jason Garrett,
exactly. And you hear it from Nick Saban. But it really is, that's what we tell our kids. We're not looking at the scoreboard. We're really focusing on a next play mentality, and we just do it one rep, one play at a time. And it's hard for the kids to get that concept, but I think the more we keep preaching it over time, the kids that have been in the program 2, 3, 4 years, they get it.
Now, there is, I mean, on the positive side, you guys were stupidly young last year. You honestly might have been the youngest team in the state. Now, you know, when you kind of look up and down it, the number of sophomores that you were playing, the number of juniors that you were playing, you bring back 10 starters on both sides of the ball, and more impressively, you got 8 3-year guys.
Mm-hmm.
How key are those guys to what you're going to be doing?
Those guys are crucial. They have to have their best year.
Mm-hmm.
They've got it. This is the year for them where it's all got to come together.
Mm-hmm.
I think last year the expectation was they knew they had to carry the load, but they weren't quite mentally ready mm-hmm. for taking that task on. But the way they worked this offseason, it shows in the way that they've showed up for summer 7-on-7. Everything's been real self-directed, more player-led, that they seem to be ready. But there's a big difference between 7-on-7 and off-season mm-hmm. than that first Thursday when we play Adamson, what it's going to look like.
Mm. And now, have you explicitly banned Pokemon Go from your football program, or is that something that comes later?
I don't really know how to address that.
You do have to catch them all, though. and I'm just saying that I think this is something you're laughing
that's
over here.
Very important.
I think it's a very
yes,
important
absolutely.
Topic.
It's got to be high on every coach's list right now.
Because I do know that, you know, if I randomly check in on any one of my players' Twitter accounts.
Yeah.
11, midnight, 1 a.m., 2 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
They're tweeting about Pokemon uh-huh. and going and catching Pokemon.
So uh-huh. Yeah, there. I mean, you got to catch them all. And I think you have to admire the fact that they're getting out and they're being active in their community by looking at their phone.
Sure.
That's good.
But it's not always a great idea.
No,
in our community, in our neighborhood.
Well, and we were talking about it on the show you were talking about yesterday about how it's just like there is going to come a point where I mean, we had two people walk off a cliff playing that game. I don't know. But how closely? This is a mildly serious question, Max.
Okay.
You look. You look like this interview is going off the rails.
I'm used to
this interview is going exactly where I wanted it to go. How closely do you follow what your kids are tweeting and your kids are Instagramming and Snapchatting?
I don't spend a lot of time digging into the details.
He's here to hire a coach to do that for him.
But right, exactly. A
social media coordinator.
That's right.
So if you're looking, if you'd like to be the social media coordinator for Fort Worth Polytechnic,
that's right.
Come
hit
on
me up.
There we go.
At Coach Rob 99.
He is Coach Robert or Chris Roberts, the head coach of the Fort Worth Polytechnic Parrots, rather. Coach, appreciate your time, man.
All right, thanks for having me.
Have a good one. We will be back from the THSCA Coaching Convention, brought to you by Dairy Max here in a bit. We are back here at THSCA Coaching Convention and Coaching School in San Antonio. Now joined the head coach of the 2A Division I state champion Canadian Wildcats. It is Coach Chris Koetting. Please tell me you flew.
No.
You drove?
Yeah. Yeah, we're used to that.
Okay, how long was the drive from Canadian?
That's about 8 hours.
I guess that's not bad.
That's just a little
it
short.
It ain't good. It ain't good, but it ain't bad. You are. I mentioned this before you sat down. I think you are the most frightening man at this coaching convention because your Wildcats are making the jump up to 3A, and I think that everyone in 3A Division II has got you. I think they're really scared of you. I think that's true.
Well, I don't know about that. but, no, you know, we're excited to be moving up. And, you know, I don't know how scared anybody should be of us right now. So, you know, we've got a lot of holes to fill. But we're excited about the kids we have coming back. We feel like that, you know, we're really excited about this group, though. But
does anything change? Like, does it, from a mindset perspective, that here you're going from, in theory, we're talking relatively here, you're going from being the small, you know, the big fish in the small pond up to being the small fish in the big pond. Does anything change as far as?
You know, it's a situation we've been in before. You know, we've been in that conference, you know, a couple other times. So it's nothing, you know, that we haven't done before, you know. So, but, you know, definitely when you move up, you know, with the bigger schools, you know, the competition level goes up, and we're going to have to step our game up as well, you know, to compete with those teams in that conference.
Were you pretty sure you guys were moving up?
Yeah. There was no doubt. Yeah. The realignment before, I was surprised that where we were, but this year we knew it was going to be. So,
you guys do from argue. Okay, let me ask you this question, because this is like a debate we have a lot. For us, it's a two. It's a two-horse race for who the most dominant team in the state was last year. It's either y'all or the coach we had on earlier, Katy, Gary Joseph. Do you have an opinion on that?
Well, I mean, I'm just honored that y'all would even mention our name in that. But, you know, I mean, well, Katy was pretty dang good. So.
they were pretty good. But at the same time, you guys rolled into a title game against a really good Refurio team. A really good Refurio team. And it was close for a little bit, and then it just seemed like once you guys hit the gas, it just seemed like you guys were on another level.
I
imagine it was like that all year.
Well, we really struggled, you know, offensively at the start of the game through the first quarter. I think we had 1 yard of offense in the first quarter, and that definitely wasn't how we wanted to start the game, but we kind of got on a roll, and it went well for us.
All right, so now you look forward to 2016, 5 starters back on offense, 4 on defense. The guy that I think everybody's going to have their eye on, Cameron Copley, who only has 15 state championship rings this time. I mean, because now, I mean, because he's, because what? He's also a star baseball player, is that right?
Basketball
player. Yeah. Okay, I mean, this guy is, it just seems like he's just a winner.
Well, in the team sports that he's competed in, he's won a state championship 5 times in a row. Jeez. So, I mean, I don't know if that's ever even been done, but he, you know, he's just a great kid. He's a great leader for us. You know, he's just a winner. You know, I mean, you know, he's not a big guy. You know, not the biggest. But man, he is a competitor, and he's tough, and really good athlete.
The defense, you guys are losing a couple of key pieces, but you bring back guys at the linebacker spot, especially at Holton Hufstetter. When you look at the defense, maybe compared to last year, what kind of comparison?
Well,
is there?
You know, we lost, you know, a couple really good defensive linemen, defensive end type guys. So it's going to be hard to replace those guys. But
Corey Chichester was
Yeah.
He was a freak. I mean that in the nicest
really
possible way.
He
was a man among boys out there.
Yeah, his motor was, you know, unmatched. Mm-hmm. So, but if we can get those guys replaced, we feel good about the rest of it. And we really feel like, you know, defensively we'll be pretty strong from day one. So we're really excited about our defense.
When you take a look at your at your region, you're moving into Region 1. A number of really impressive teams up there as well. Childress comes to mind. Idaloo, always very good. Yeah. Cisco. How do you assess what you're walking into as far as Region 1 is concerned?
Well, I like you said, I mean, I think Region 1 is very strong, you know, and some of those same teams that when we were in that conference last time, we played against the Ciscos and the Idaloos and the those guys, Sonoras and you know, Eastland, all those guys, they're going to be really strong, but we're looking forward to it, looking forward to the challenge of it. So
should be fun. Now our podcast is sponsored by our friends at Dairy Max. So I do want to ask you, we're asking all the coaches here about nutrition. How much are you talking to your kids about nutrition? How much are you talking to your kids about what the kind of fuel they're putting in their body?
We Coach Cavalier, our strength and conditioning guy, he talks to the kids a lot about, you know, what they need to be putting in their bodies and eating and things like that. But he's kind of the expert on that. So,
but it's safe to say that that's definitely a key part of your of Canadians, not just recent success, but all time?
Well, I don't know about that, but but yeah, it is important, you know.
Absolutely. He is Coach Chris Koetting, the head coach of the Canadian Wildcats. Coach, thanks for your time. Appreciate it.
You bet. Thanks for having me on.
Welcome back to DCTF Live here at the THSCA Coaches Convention and Coaches School here in beautiful San Antonio, the City of Angels.
That's not what it's called.
That's exactly
that
what it's called.
Under no circumstances.
We are so pleased to be joined by the new head honcho, the new head eagle at New Diana. Central Texas people know and love him. He is Robbie Coplin. Hey, Coach.
Hey, well, nice to be here.
Your first head coaching job at New Diana. Did you have an offer from Old Diana?
I'm really not sure how the whole name New Diana came about. Well, I think you can ask people in town and you get like 100 different answers.
You have, you even though this is your first head coaching job, you've been around this game long, long time. Why now the leap to the head coaching position?
It was just something I've always wanted to do. Mm-hmm. You know, it a chance to go and try to do the same thing we've done at some bigger schools and do it myself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and implement what I've learned from people like Chad Morris and Hank Carter and Matt Green. Mm-hmm. And do it on a smaller scale, and also – you know, it was a chance for me to move back closer to my parents. I grew up in Southwest Arkansas, and my wife is from South Arkansas as well. So it was a chance for us to move back closer to family as well. A
lot of positives there. So then you got hired when? What time of the year?
I want to say the board meeting was like February 19th.
Okay.
So I was on board the last week of February.
So you've been on the job, let's call it 6 months? 6 months?
Yes.
5 months, 6 months? Has it been like drinking from a fire hose?
A little bit. There's a lot going on in New Diana right now. They had already had in the plans for they had already started the plans to do a new track and field turf on the football field. So that's still underway. It's still in the process. When I left, the turf wasn't in town yet, and they were still laying the liner down and all the drainage stuff. So I don't know if the football field is going to be ready by our first scrimmage or not on August 12th, but I can't control that, so I'm not going to worry about it. The school board voted to help me remodel the field house, mm-hmm. So we're in the process of that. And we start August 1st on practice, and our lockers are set to ship on July 26th. So, there's a little stress, yeah. Me being in charge of that, I have a little stress right now, but I can't control it. And, you know, if we have to send our kids home with their football helmets the first week of school, the first week of practice, and, you know, and have them bring them back every day because they don't have anywhere to put it, we'll just do that. I'm going to worry about the football side.
Yeah, it's going to be good for them. I'm always interested in coaches who have been coaching at very big schools. You know, Lake Travis, now a 6A school, you know, a long time what was then 4A, now 5A power. You're dropping down to 3A. You know, you're dropping down to 3A Division II. I imagine a bit of a different ball game for you.
It is. It's a big adjustment. You know, it's a little more difficult to hire coaches. Mm-hmm. You know, because they're, you know, talking. You have to work a lot. I mean, not that you don't work with the principal of the school you're at anyway, but you're really in conjunction with them now because I mean, there's so many pieces of the jigsaw puzzle to fit mm-hmm. together, and it's very difficult to get the right pieces because there's so many classes that they want to try to offer, but you also have to have the right teaching field to make it all fit. It's very difficult. That's the biggest adjustment for me,
really.
Is trying to make that all fit together.
And the other thing is that you're taking over a program that's coming off of, let's call it, a very forgettable season. You know, 0-10 season. How do you start the process of, I think, the best way to put it is teaching these kids how to win again?
One thing is, you know, you come in and, I mean, this is something that I learned from Hank and Chad, you know, is just, you know, number one, you just want to teach them how to do things right,
yeah.
You know, build character into them. And, you know, and I really believe that, you know, if you teach them how to do things right and we have a certain standard that we expect them to work up to every day and, you know, and we're not going to sacrifice and we're not going to allow them to do anything less than that every day at workout and during practice or whatever. And if they do that, then I think the winning will take care of itself eventually.
And you guys are kind of, boy, out of the frying pan into the fire. You get a pretty tough district. Dangerfield looks very good. Hooks looks like they're going to be pretty good as well. What for you? Reasonable. What would be a successful first year for you at New Diana?
Obviously, you know, you have goals. I would love to say that we can come right out of the box and, you know, be 5-5 mm-hmm. and make the playoffs and stuff, you know. But, I mean, really, I mean, if you can win, if the chips fall right, you mm-hmm. can win 3 games and make the playoffs in a 7-team district. Sure. If everything happens mm-hmm. a certain way. Mm-hmm. You know, and I would say, I mean, I would be – you know, obviously, I would like to win more than 3 games, but, you know, if those are the only 3 games I'll win and I make playoffs, I'd say that'd be a successful season.
All right, now I got 2 more questions for you. First of all, we are sponsored by our friends at Dairy Max, and so I want to ask you, you've been around Lake Travis, a very successful program. You're about to turn New Diana into a very successful program. For you guys, how much is nutrition part of what you guys are putting together?
It's a very big part just because, I mean, as much as you really have to prepare the kids' bodies mm-hmm. physically, you know, and especially at the 6A level, we had to do it at Lake Travis. It was unbelievable what those kids' bodies go through during a season. You know, and I'm sure our kids at the 3A level playing both ways it's going to be probably as taxing or more taxing on them as well. So, you know, it's like I think it's very important for them to, you know, put the – right things in their body to help their body recover from all the damage that they put it through.
Absolutely. And now the other question I have is that this gentleman behind me, his name is
Max.
Mark?
It's Max.
Max. Max, Max Thompson. I understand you guys go back a little bit?
Yeah, we got to know each other when I got on board at Lake Travis. He likes to fancy himself a soccer boy.
Boy, he does. Wow, you have got him pegged. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, he knows the deal.
You know, I had to coach some soccer while I was at Lake Travis.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I enjoyed it, but I'll tell you this. I'm not coaching soccer anymore. I don't miss the weather that the Texas soccer season is.
Yeah, that's true.
That's
part
true.
Of it. That's awful.
Because if you think about it, the football season, the weather is kind of perfect. That you have first couple games, non-district, hot. Gonna be hot.
Right.
You're gonna be steamy. Gonna start to cool off. You get in that nice cooling off period, and then if you're playing in November, December, which you hope to be,
right,
then you're playing in cold weather. But soccer season is unforgiving.
Yeah, and you know, I would say, you know, I could probably count on one hand how many games that we played at Lake Travis. You know, playing 16 games a season.
Yeah.
How many were just really miserable.
Mm-hmm.
You
yeah.
know, there were a few. I know we had
a couple.
We played Alamo Heights in
yeah.
2009. That was
yeah.
that was miserable.
Yeah.
In 13 when we played A&M Consolidated, that was
yeah.
bad.
Yeah.
Those were probably 2 of the coldest games that I've ever coached in.
That nope. A&M or the Alamo Heights game, it was at Bobcat Stadium
yes.
in San Marcos. The AC was stuck on in the press box.
Oh,
it's already
gosh.
30 degrees outside with wind chill.
Right.
And then the AC was stuck. It was 42 degrees in the press box.
Well, if I remember right, we canceled school that day
yeah.
because of ice and snow.
Ice
and Lake Travis.
Still played.
And then we
yeah.
still drove to San Marcos because yeah. it melted off about noon.
Yeah.
So, and that was all up in the air whether we were going to play the game or not.
Man,
so.
I just came from Chicago, and the high yesterday was 76, and I was like, this is a little chilly. Can we turn it up a little bit? Robbie Coplin, the new head coach of the New Diana Eagles. Coach, appreciate your time. And best of luck this season.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.